it was more, there wasn't a lot of brothers getting tattooed. You know, the Mexicans had full sleeves, like the homies, but a lot of them were done by single needle by doing time. So if you had sleeves, they would ask you where you do your time at.
Right.
This was the emergence of regular guys, working guys, getting sleeves. And a lot of them worked in the business in Hollywood. And Ed Hardy was probably the biggest star amongst us.
Right.
Mark Mahoney was a big star. Jack Rudy, Baby Ray, Bob Roberts. These were names that you would hear. Coyote, Freddie Negrete. You know, these guys were famous way before the internet.
Right.
And we're notorious.
You know, Bob Roberts one time told me that I asked him if he would tattoo my head. And he said, yeah, but only if you let me do the entire thing from the front of your hairline all the way back, the whole top piece. And I was a little bit too timid to get it all outlined that day, so I didn't do it.
I probably
should go back.
To have a Bob Roberts headpiece is classic.
That's
a
big one.
But those are the guys we looked up to. We were like bikers. You know, Freddie was probably the only Chicano in there. But Jack Rudy had grew up in a Mexican neighborhood and drew like a homie, you know. So we were in there. But now if you look on Instagram, you know, Chicanos, Mexican Americans were the pretty much deepest in that shit. And the art form, especially in fine line black and gray, right? Now you see pieces coming, you know, Germany, France, and South America, and all these guys are doing amazing work. They're doing it in places where they probably don't even know what it means. They just know it looks good.
Do you miss that era of tattooing when there was more regional styles and it was more, stuff was more specific to an area, whereas now everybody's learning from each other online and it's probably less of a, you know, it's like that in music as well. It's like now you could hear somebody from Milwaukee and he sounds like he's from LA.
Yeah. I mean, it's a time to reminisce, and I'm fortunate I was there for the, you know, we even call it the innocent time because it wasn't so polished and perfect. And, you know, there's reality shows, and I have nothing to do with tattoos. They're just hanging out in the tattoo shop and arguing over their old lady and shit. But back then, you had a lot of rules and respect levels. So to open a shop, you had asked for permission to open up a shop. To buy a tattoo machine, you had asked permission to do that. Things were definitely, everyone knew each other a lot better. But now you have to, hey, it is what it is. There's tattoo reality shows. You either embrace that shit or you get left behind. So we just try to embrace it and maintain the shit we learned from then. You know?
Is it hard not to get salty about how whitewash shit has gotten, how ridiculous, how commercialized it's gotten?
I mean, I'm in the middle because I am in business. So I like that part.
Your business grows.
Yeah, like I've turned down all the reality shows for tattooing because part of my success is I'm hard to find. And people don't know. They see an interview here and there, but they really don't know our day to day. So I wanted to keep that and I didn't want to. But those shows helped me in a roundabout way where it relaxes the masses to let me in. To do, right now I'm doing the LA Clippers merch and Modelo and a major, I got two Vans coming out. So we have these like corporate gigs, but then to balance that, I'll walk into a school in South Central and talk to a high school class.
But it seems like you will go and work with these corporations, but you primarily make it about your art and not, oh, let me just go do a Nike thing where I'm sitting on camera for Nike for a while.
No, you want to be able to try to translate the culture to, you know, other people that are in the same vibe you are, you know? In other words, I'm using the corporate company as a tool to forward and push forward the stuff. They're going to do it anyways. So they might as well have me or another street artist that, you know, grew up here, let us do it, you know what I mean? Because they've been, you know, imitating and faking hip-hop art for a long time. So it's a, but I, yeah, you can watch those shows and start getting angry, you know, for sure. I know the OGs are fucked, man. They do not like that shit.
Right.
But it's going down.
it's a weird decision for you too, because it's kind of like if you totally don't do any of the corporate stuff or you never go on camera, you're kind of just opening the door for somebody who's a commercialized, goofy version of you to come in and be like, oh, I'll be the guy who goes on the news and talks about this world or whatever, you know?
Yeah, I was telling the apprentices the other day in the studio, it's not good enough to be a dope tattoo artist. That's just mandatory. There's everyone can draw, apparently, what I've been seeing. These motherfucking kids are dope. Mm. They take my formula and they're able to run with it. You know what I mean? And add their own shit onto it.
And they're 20, so they got plenty of time to sit around all day. Yeah.
But that's even not good enough. You have to do that and be ready to be put on stage or a podcast and have to articulate the shit and speak in front of a crowd and do these type of things. So that's the way the world is now, is that you have to have all corners covered. Mm. And I learned on accident.
Right. It feels like you, for years and to some extent still, became like the default hip-hop tattoo artist. Where if you asked a rapper, you know, who you fuck with as a tattoo artist or who did this or whatever, if you were ever going to see a tattoo artist in a hip-hop context, it was Mr. Cartoon. How did you get to that point of being that ubiquitous and just being around and just being known on that level?
Well, first of all, I love hip hop. You know what I mean? I mean, I listen to a lot of classic soul, you know, late 1950s, 60s and 70s classic soul music. You know, I'm really, me and my wife, that's all we listen to. But of course, being that I am a graffiti writer, I have been to the East Coast. I'm a writer and graph writer at heart, you know what I mean? So I approached that in the art of tattooing with hip hop. So it was something that kind of happened by accident. I started going on tour with Cypress Hill. Mm. My boy, Stevan Oriol, he was the road manager and he would take me on tour and he was like, bring your tattoo shit with you. We'd be backstage for 6 hours waiting for them to go on stage.
A lot of downtime as a rapper.
A lot of downtime in the backstage, and you're in Europe and shit, so you can't just go home or nothing. So long story short, I just was put in that position. Luck is being prepared for opportunity. Mm. You know, that's a cliche, but it rings true in certain areas where those times that you're practicing at home and no one's watching, that's the shit. That's the shit that makes you different. And so when the door does open, you're able to walk through it.
You have a special relationship with Cypress Hill, as opposed to, you've worked with a ton of other rappers, but culturally and...
Oh, for sure.
You and B Real on the Smoke Box, you guys just seemed like best friends.
Yeah, I mean, you know, getting to know B, Muggs, and Bobo, all those guys, you know, they're from here. These are our local heroes. We don't have many heroes in our community that we can be like, man, these motherfuckers grew up in Southgate, you know?
And people might end up forgetting, just because time sort of makes people forget about shit, but the fact that Cypress Hill were the first Hispanic rappers in the mid-early 90s, I mean, that just says a lot.
Yeah, it had their own style, and, you know, Muggs moved over from New York and moved to Southgate, which is borderline in South Central, you know what I mean? You know, Muggs had to fight everybody, and you know, he's a character, man. But he is the overseed, like master of that whole thing, you know, being able to mastermind. So I watch these guys do press. I watched them go and do interviews and how they moved, and they had managers and accountants. And so I started to mirror myself after that. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So you are, your mom says, you know, you are who you hang around. So being around people that are a little bit further from you, man, it fires you up.
That's so interesting, because like the same way that you were looking at your friend who was doing murals or whatever, now you're all of a sudden looking at Cypress Hill, but you're thinking, well, they're doing the music business and there's already a very established formula of how you make money off of music.
Right.
Tattooing is very new for that. Art in general in a hip hop context was sort of, it was new, the idea of like really thinking of yourself as somebody who is really forming their business in the hip hop scene. Is that sort of the similar thing? You're watching Cypress Hill and you're like, I could be this professional and organized and I can have these relationships.
Yeah, when you see street guys do it, it dumbs it down to where you can understand it. Mm. Hearing Suits talk about it, it's hard to take in. But seeing the fellas do it, you're like, oh, shit, I could do this. So I mirrored them by going, say, I go to Japan. and I'll go to the northern part of Sendai, and I'll put snipes up on the poles that I was there.
Uh-huh.
And then I will go do press. I'll do any interview I can get my hands on and do it in Japan. And I would work my way down city by city till I end up in Osaka. Uh-huh. And I'd stay there for like 3 months in Japan.
Really?
And that's how I started to build my shit. And I would do what they did. Press, interviews, anything I could do. Stickers out, merch. And started to try to step out of my body and say, if I was managing this artist, what would I do with them?
Right.